Banda Vida Vazante Roshate Vasonta La Rei Sonta Ida Brata Bande Vida Sonja Tariga Brando La Rei Sonja Tariga Brata Ida Vasante Ida Vasante Le Ronze Ijo Sariga Brakida Sonta Ida Vahatese O Radege Bonza Ida Brakta Ida Vasanta Ida Bohusa O Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Oh, welcome to this special segment of prayer. Welcome you to our Sunday online service with our very own dear man of God, Reverend Pastor Hilton Moyo. Praise the Lord. Right now, we're going to continue in prayer. Yes. We're going to attune ourselves to the word of God. The man of God is going to be teaching this wonderful morning. Hallelujah. Yes, I'm with my dear brother, Deacon Prince, and we're going to pray. You're going to join us as we pray. Hallelujah. Yes. Go ahead and speak in other tongues.
Praise be to the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The word of God says in the book of Luke chapter 18 verse 1, says he taught them a parable. That's Jesus Christ. He taught them a parable that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Even these lockdowns that have been declared upon the nations, they will not derail us from the inspiration that we have to pray. And we're going to continue in prayer. And I'm going to pray for the man of God who is going to be standing today to proclaim the word of God. We're going to declare that his lips are anointed. We're going to declare that his voice is amplified. Even as he's going to be proclaiming the word of God, even the passerbys are going to derail and listen to the word of the Lord. Let's continue in prayer. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
The man of God wrote in the book, The Power of Prayer,
yes,
that pray always. Hallelujah. Yes. Pray without ceasing. Praise the Lord. One last time we're going to pray and thank God for this service. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And thank God for the word which the man of God is going to bring unto us live right now today. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So one last time we're going to lift up our hands just for a few seconds, and we're going to thank God for this special service the man of God is going to bring us unto us live today. Hallelujah.
Oh,
Thank you, Lord God, for the word of God.
Yes, sir.
This morning, I'm so expectant of what God is going to be doing unto us.
Absolutely.
through our men of God.
Absolutely.
Praise the Lord.
The presence of God is here strong.
Oh, and hallelujah.
I know that He is ready to minister to us.
Praise
and
the
to
Lord.
Transform our lives even for good. Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. You know, the man of God wrote unto us good books on
yes,
prayer.
Sir.
Praise
yes.
the Lord. We've just been yes, praying right now. And the atmosphere is charged. I'm sure it's charged wherever you are at home, wherever you're joining us this morning. Praise the Lord. The man of God wrote the book, Power of Prayer.
Yes.
This book teaches us on how to pray effectively and how to get results through prayer. Praise the Lord.
Excellent.
And
yes, sir.
Today we have one of the copies, the book, Power of Prayer, which was written by our very own man of God, Reverend Pastor Hilton Moyo. Today, if you would want to get this copy, just inbox us on our Facebook page, on any of our platforms, so that you get this book, Power of Prayer. Praise the Lord.
Yes,
it's a greater exposure. You will know how to pray and get results every time you pray. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
We don't just pray for no reason. Hallelujah.
But we pray even with revelation.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord. Hallelujah.
And we know that whenever we pray, armed and begged with revelation,
praise the Lord,
answers are made available immediately.
Oh, hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And the man of God has also given us another book entitled Truth Away from Money.
Oh, hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the
it's
Lord.
A glorious expose on kingdom finance and a teaching on how to make money the God way. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
We'll discover from this booklet, Truth Away from Money, that we are not time away from making money, but we are truth away. And that truth is encapsulated even in this booklet. Make sure that you procure this book so that you make money even in these last days.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise
so if
God.
You've got any of the copies, Power of Prayer, Truth Away from Money, inbox right away, and there are people who assist you on that note. Praise
Most
the Lord. We also have a powerful book the man of God wrote. That is our new creation realities module.
Praise
our
Lord.
NCRM.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
The man of God has been teaching us, has been edging us to win souls. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And after we've won souls, this book, the new creation realities module, will then enable those souls to know what it is to be born again. Praise the Lord.
Praise
How should
Lord.
I live my life as a Christian after I'm born again?
Yes.
Everything is all there in the book. The NCRM, our New Creation Realities module, written by our very own man of God, Pastor Hilton Moy. Praise the Lord.
This particular book covers quite a number of important issues that will help us to mature and to grow quickly in the things of God.
Hallelujah.
It teaches us on the creation and the fall of man. It teaches us on being born again.
Praise the Lord.
It even teaches us on Christianity itself.
Oh, hallelujah.
These are fundamental truths that every newly born again believer must be aware of.
Praise the Lord. The list is endless. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
For more, get yourself a copy of the New Creation Realities module. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Man, Deacon said, tell us more on the social platforms we have at FGKC.
Praise the Lord. We have made it a point to avail ourselves as a ministry on several social platforms.
Hallelujah.
And we have made it a point that this social platforms constantly disseminate the word of God to the world.
Praise the Lord.
We are available on Facebook as Fellowship City Incorporated. This is our official page that we have on Facebook. Make sure that you join in and you follow and you'll be blessed even as you receive the word of God from our prophet.
Hallelujah.
Yes,
we're also available on Twitter and on Instagram. Follow the man of God's account at Rev. Pastor Hilton Moyo on Instagram and on Twitter. He's available, praise the Lord. Amen. And also available on WhatsApp, praise the Lord. So that it'd be easier for us to fellowship with other Christians. Hallelujah. On WhatsApp, you can inbox us right away on the Facebook page where you're watching us from, and you get the details. Praise the Lord.
Absolutely.
Praise the Lord. And for other sermons, we're available on YouTube, sir.
Yes, yes. And we are uploading power-packed videos for you to enjoy and for you to watch. Make sure that you subscribe to our YouTube page, Pastor Hilton Moyo, and you are going to be receive a daily dosage of God's word undiluted.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Glory be to God.
Right now we're going to receive our dear pastor, Pastor Idris, as he takes us on for prayer. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise Hallelujah. The Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Right where you are. It has been a glorious week which the man of God has given unto us an opportunity to pray with him online on Blue Jeans exactly from 9 o'clock. We are going to pray, praying concerning this mandate. We know the Bible, the word of God says that we are the light of the world. We are the city and the salt of the earth. We are restrainers of powers of evil and powers of men over the face of the earth as conduits of heaven. Remember he said, as he is, so are we here on earth. We're going to pray now, praying for the nations. We declare concerning this pandemic that it has come to naught and that the power of God has prevailed. We continually declare that the free course move of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ reaches to every heart. The Bible says that, and the word of God shall cover the earth, shall grow forth unto the earth as the waters that cover the seas. So we're going to continually declare that the word of God is growing impact. We pray that even nations of the nations and member states within each and every continent embrace the glorious light of the word of God, and they formulate legislative that propagate the ministration of the word of God, even in police formation. Go ahead where you are. Begin to pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Spirit of the Lord. We declare that countries are continually opening up in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The word of God is moving frequently and hindered, even in cyberspace. We declare, Spirit of the Lord, even in covenants, that my God and policy makers are sitting Mondeleke Prando, Shubalika Parabakona Malabakabayata. The church is marching forth and mightily across the word of God and prevail in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We declare that. We are creating waves. Our men of God teach us that when we pray, we cause crusades to break forth. We cause winning of souls to be easy. We declare that the anointing of God's Spirit moves even on the scales of those that have not believed, that they see the light of the gospel of the Lord. Even in Zimbabwe, we are declaring, in Africa, in Southern Africa, and all these member states, that we will not consign to plans of evil. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we glide from the shore. As the sign of the Lord unshakable, we made proclamations declaring that the church of the living God is marching forth. That the plans, my God, of the evil comes to naught. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we grind obstacles against the gospel to powder. We restrain evil men perpetuating, my God, the closure of church. We declare, oh, there is victory. He has given unto us victory to celebrate. He has given unto us victory in Christ. When he rose on that cross, when he ascended, he gave us victory. And there is victory for the church. There is victory for the church. Oh, we see church space opening up. Oh, we see crusades marching forth. We see a great harvest and end time revival.
revival of the church. Oh, hallelujah. Continue in an atmosphere of prayer. Even as you are about to receive the man of God coming forth, you are going to prepare your heart continually to receive unto the podium. Even as we share the word of God in accordance to giving, remain in an atmosphere of prayer, because in prayer you are made stronger. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. When we pray like this, we know that the world is changed. Praise the Lord. We're not speaking in tongues for nothing. You're going to quickly turn with me your Bibles to the book of Luke chapter 5, even as we get to the time of giving. Praise the Lord. We are reading from Luke chapter 5. Thank you, Spirit of God. Hallelujah. The Bible says in the verse 4 that now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answering said unto him, to Jesus, Master, we have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came, and they filled both ships, so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. Praise the Lord. The Bible here brings to us a scenario where the disciples, or those that had made a choice to follow Jesus, were in an unfruitful toil. They were involved in an economic activity which was not giving them profit. They were involved in daily clocking in and out of work, but there was no salary to show for it. They were involved in a lot of productive energies, but there was no fruit to show for it. The Bible says the word of God came to them through Jesus, and he gave them an instruction to do not only what they were been doing, but to do it with a different attitude this time. The word came from a righteous man, Jesus. And the Bible says when they launched unto the deep according to the instruction of Jesus, they had a great catch. But something is opened up to Simon and to who is Peter. The Bible says he saw what was happening, and he diagnosed his position, and he said, it is because I am a sinful man that I was toiling all night and I did not get profit. And he recognized that this kind of fruitfulness only happens to those that are righteous. That's why he says, depart from me, O Lord, for I am a sinful man. That is why I've been toiling and I haven't been seeing any profit. This morning, I want to bring you to the attention, even as you are preparing your giving this morning, I want to bring you to the attention that you are now the righteousness of God. Jesus came, died on the cross, was buried, he resurrected, and we are seated together with him in the heavenly places. We gained from him gifts when we got born again. Bible says they that receive the grace of God and the gift of righteousness shall reign in this life through Jesus. Through the grace of God, we are given righteousness, and we use this righteousness to reign, to dominate the earth, both animate and inanimate things. Jesus, being the righteous man, he had an understanding that from his position of righteousness, he can speak to the fish and cause them to gather into a net until the net break. From your position of righteousness as a child of God, born again, filled with the Spirit, given and having received this gift of righteousness, you have the ability to reign in this life. I declare that because you are righteous, you are reigning in your financial life in the name of Jesus. Because you are righteous, you are fruitful in your economic endeavors in the name of Jesus. What makes your giving big in the house of God is not the amount that you have in your hand.
What makes your giving big is the righteousness of God that is in you. What makes your giving acceptable is not the kind of packaging you give to your gift, but it is from who is the person that is performing the giving. From that state of righteousness where you are, when you perform an act of worship, it is acceptable to God. Did you not read in the book of James chapter 5 verse 16b that the Bible says an effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much? It is not prayer that is powerful. It is prayer of a righteous man. That's why the Bible says God, that the prayer of the wicked is an abomination to God. If prayer was powerful, the prayer of the wicked was going to be powerful. But the prayer of the righteous man, there is things that when a righteous man does, they give different results than the results that it will give when it is done by a sinful man. From your position of righteousness today, that giving is not average. That giving cannot be disdained. That giving cannot be looked down upon. You are going to perform giving in the house of God. And because of the righteousness that is in you, it causes your gift to be right. It causes your gift to be acceptable. Today we give because we understand that when we give, there is power in our giving from the position in which we give. Praise the Lord. You are giving from your position of righteousness. You are giving from your grace that God has given you and the gift of righteousness that He has given you. And because of that, there is power in your giving, just like there is power in the prayer of the righteousness. Power to release you from oppression, power to release you and liberate your spirit and liberate your finances for the next and higher level. Even as you prepare your offerings there, you are going to communicate them in an instruction that is being given to you on the live feed on Facebook. Make sure you wire those transactions, wire those amounts to those stated accounts. Even as I pray, refuse to let a service like this go without your giving representing you in the house of God. I'm praying towards your giving right now as you receive the blessing of God. Praise the Lord, because in any given point in time, givers are more blessed than takers. Praise the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you even as we present to you our gifts from the position that, Lord, you have given us, the position of righteousness, the position of reigning. We declare that these gifts open doors for us in the name of Jesus. We are economically relevant and we are reigning in our economy in Jesus' name. Father, we declare that even as we engage in productive energies, we count profit in Jesus' name. We declare that there shall be no loss in our camp and there is nothing that is due to us as the children of God mentioned as a blessing in your word that shall skip any of us that has locked in through our giving. We thank you for the word that is coming to empower us and to position us for insurmountable gains in the kingdom of God. In the name of Jesus, even as we have given to the gospel, we declare that as the gospel is moving forward, so does our lives. As the gospel is moving forward, so does our businesses. We can only grow and there is no stopping us. In the name of Jesus, we honor you. We love you. We give you praise. Hallelujah. You shall go ahead and lift up your hands and worship together with the music ministers, even as we thank God and even as we heartily do so after that we have given. God bless you. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Sing with me, great is our God.
Great is our God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sing with me, powerful is our God.
Powerful is our God.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, we raise the hallelujah to you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sing, great is our God.
Great is our God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We bless your name. Together wherever you are and bless the name of Jesus. We bless your name. Nobody like you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Powerful is our God.
Powerful is our God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Of my praise, hallelujah. Come on, lift up worship the Lord. Oh, heaven and earth adore your name. Angels bow before your throne. Sing hallelujah. Heaven and earth adore your name. Angels bow before your throne. Sing hallelujah. Sing heaven and earth. Heaven and earth adore your name. Angels bow before your throne. Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
Oh, 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 oh. Heaven and earth adore your name. Angels bow before your throne. Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
Oh, sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah, we bless your name. Lift up your hands and worship the Lord. Lord, you are awesome in this place. Oh, you are glorious in all of your ways. We lift our hands to worship you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are awesome in this place. In this place, oh yeah, you are awesome in this place, faithful God, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You do wonders, you do wonders in our lives. Mighty God, you do wonders, you do wonders in our lives. In our life, faithful God,
faithful God,
hallelujah,
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 hallelujah.
Sing, Lord, you do wonders,
you do wonders in our life.
We see you do. Wonders,
you do wonders in our life.
You keep on doing wonders.
You do wonders in our life.
You're the faithful God.
Faithful God.
Your hands and bless the name of Jesus. He is worthy of all of our praise. Father, you do wonders in the midst. And we thank you, Lord, you do wonders in the midst. God say, awesome God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Tabida fonte balagabanzu te barasha takala mahazines. One more time, lift your hands where you are and worship him. He is a faithful God. He is awesome in our midst and he is worthy of praise. Father, we give you honor. Father, we give you worship, we give you adoration because you are God. Zento brote kila managabanzu zobrote liga balagabahas. Zinta liga balogo bontre suku bonte brahaza teka bashatelea. Wala manzu te brahaze ki manzu te brahastis. Everywhere from where you are watching me from, lift up your hands and pray in the Holy Spirit. Zikabazanza bani shate kole bosata bahastis. Father, we bless you, we bless you, we lift you. Kujabalega manto brohozetes. We say your name is exalted, it is lifted. Makale bonte brajakani moshonte valiga sonte brahazo dese. Ole bonte brahazo komonzo te brohozo komonte brahaza desetes. En shabalega manta balego bozu le bontre zikabalaga bantre suku buya sata balahastis. Uela barre choko shule bontre zikabalaga bantre suku buya sata balahastis. Wenta kade bontre zikabalega bantre suku buya sata balahastis. Shabalega bantre suku buya sata balahastis. Father, we thank you, we bless your name. Oh, hallelujah. The Lord is gracious and he is kind. Oh, hallelujah. Well, welcome you to this wonderful program. Thank you so much for tuning in from where you are watching us from. Keep those comments coming so that we may know that you are watching us, so that we may know that you are participating. And even as the word of God is going on, just keep on talking to us, keep on posting so that we may communicate and we may hear that the word of the Lord is being published this morning. But we thank God that we're not limited in ministering the gospel, and we will keep ministering the gospel even in these times.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Now lift up your hands where you are. Hallelujah. We have a weekly prayer that is going on every day from 9 p.m. to 9:30. We are praying for the nations of the world and for our mandate. And if time permits us, we'll keep on sharing with you on that today so that you may understand what we are doing. But for a few minutes, I would want you to lift up your hands and keep praying with us. Just keep playing for us that kind of song. It's wonderful. Even as we pray, just give us that music, even as we keep on ministering this morning. From where you are watching us for, you are praying in the Holy Spirit. Pray specifically for your nation, from where you are watching us from. Pray for the nation to which you belong. Your nation needs you right now. Even in this time of pandemic, we are praying. Mita bale bo preso zo bo ne ka bajo ne bo presi za ka ba za ne bo presi za ka ba sa. Oh, se ne ka bajo ne bo presi ka ba la ka ba preso zo zo ya.
In the name of Jesus.
Shaka mando lo ko bo zo ne bo presi ka ba sa ya ba ya. Shaka ko lo bo presi ka ba la ka ba preso zo ya ba ka ba preso zo bo ya za tese. Pray.
We thank you, Father, Lord, for
in the name of Jesus.
Father, we thank you for the opportunity to make changes and to make power available. And Lord, we thank you that you answer us because we belong to you. You answer us, Lord, because you say that the prayer of righteous men maketh power available. It maketh tremendous changes everywhere. Father, you answer us because we pray according to your will.
Yes, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
And Lord, Father, we thank you for the power that you have given us to dominate the nations and to teach them righteousness. We reign in Christ. And Lord, Father, we tell thee the agenda of the Assyrian spirit will not prevail.
Yes, Lord, thank you.
There is no agenda of darkness that shall prevail against the church of the living God. We declare that the effects of COVID-19 are declared null and void. The plans of the enemy to plunge this world into darkness are declared null and void. We are marching on.
Hallelujah.
And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all the world.
Amen.
And then the end shall come.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Right, I would want you to take your notes, to take your book where you're writing, or your tablet, or your phone as you are connected. We are going to go through several scriptures this morning before we are done. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We are teaching on the seven factors of fruitful Christianity. Seven factors of fruitful Christianity. Now, many Christians have not been raised in the teaching ministry, and this is a problem. You see, God wants God's people to be taught. God wants God's people to be ministered to be elevated, to be equipped, and to be trained in the things of God. And this can only be possible through the teaching ministry of the Word of God. And so if you are one of those Christians that don't like the teaching ministry of the Word of God, I would have to reprove you this morning. That like, get to be formed about a place where the Word of God is taught.
Praise the Lord.
Get to be formed.
Hallelujah.
You cannot grow by the preaching ministry. Preaching is announcing the gospel.
Yes.
And Jesus went about preaching to all sinners. You are announcing the gospel, but believers are not announced the gospel to.
Yes.
Believers are taught. And he went about teaching in the synagogues. He was preaching in the villages and in the towns, and he was teaching in the synagogue. In the church, we teach the Word of God. Because that's the way that is going to be able to build you up.
Yes.
To prop you up in the gospel.
Praise the Lord.
And as a Christian, you ought to keep on growing. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And so, you know, having preached in most places and having been around in the body of Christ for a long time, I will tell you, one of the greatest challenges we have is that we have a lot of believers that have never been taught. They don't know the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They don't even know the factors of Christianity, the foundations of the gospel. What makes this gospel the gospel? What makes Jesus Jesus? What are you supposed to know as a Christian? And what makes up your life as a Christian? You see, your Christian life cannot be fruitful until you know what you are really supposed to be doing and what you really are supposed to be knowing, so that you can have a more fruitful Christianity. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
In Philemon 1 verse 6, it says, and making your faith effectual. You see, most believers, their faith cannot be effective. He says, by
searching
and knowing the things that have been freely given you in Christ Jesus. Do you know the things that have been given to you in Christ Jesus? But you cannot know unless you've been taught. Teaching brings the knowledge of God. Teaching brings the knowledge of the word of God. Can you give me an amen?
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 6, let me begin from there. Hebrews chapter 6. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hebrews chapter 6. Oh, glory, glory, glory.
Praise the Lord.
I will want the reading from verse 1 to 2. Verse 1 to 2. Verse 1
Praise
to
Lord.
2.
The Bible reads, Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ.
Leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ.
Let us go on unto perfection.
Let us go on unto perfection.
Not laying again the foundations of repentance from dead works.
He says, not laying again the foundations of repentance from dead works.
And of faith toward God.
And of faith towards God.
Of the doctrine of baptisms.
The doctrine of baptism.
And of the laying on of hands.
Of the laying on of hands.
And of the resurrection of the dead.
And of the resurrection of the dead.
And of eternal judgment.
And eternal judgment. Now, if you are a Christian and you are hearing these things for the first time, you are part of what Paul is wanting to address here. This is, he calls them elementary babyish teachings. If you are still teaching these things that he is mentioning, about baptism, about the resurrection of the dead, about the laying on of hands, you see, when he says laying on of hands, these are Christians that always must be laid hands upon. You see, they understand that doctrine. But it says this is the elementary teachings of Christ, you see. They are sick, they need healing, they need to be laid hands. They have this problem, they need laying hands. You know, they're not sleeping well at home, they need laying on of hands. This says these are the elementary. It didn't say they're not truths. They are elementary truths. You see, just like when we went to school, you see, you don't just begin by doing advanced level. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
There are elementary teachings that will then be a foundation for where you are going. But you can't remain with elementary teachings. We remember in those days when they would ask you and they would say, 2 minus 1, you say, it's 1. And then they say, 1 minus 2. So then you say, it can't. And they will give you good, excellent, you know how the primary teachers used to write it. They say, good, very excellent. And you are happy. Why? Because you made it. But then, 10 years down the line, you cannot be still doing the same thing because the grade that you will be at 10 years after cannot allow you to say 1 minus 2.
It can't.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Which means there is a grade. It was a truth for a particular stage. But there is a stage where you grow into where that truth does not suffice anymore.
Hallelujah.
Give me an amen.
Amen.
Read verse 1 again. Read verse 1 again.
Hallelujah. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ.
He says, therefore, leaving. He says, you are supposed to. That means this is a movement. He says, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ.
Let us go on unto perfection.
Let us go on unto perfection.
Hallelujah.
My brother, my sister, you must come to perfection.
Praise the Lord.
Perfection is where Christ wants you to operate from. This gospel did not come for us to remain imperfect. It came to us imperfect, but it's supposed to make us perfect.
Hallelujah.
What have you known? I want you to just share with us, even on the live broadcast, maybe how many years you've been in Christianity. How many years have you been born again? According to the earthly calendar, of course. Have you been born again for 5 years? Have you been a Christian for 10 years? Have you been a Christian for 7 years, for 3 years, for 2 years, or for 6 months? Just tell us, how many years have you been born again?
Hallelujah.
You see, he says, let us go on unto perfection. Which means it doesn't matter how long you might have been born again. There is a perfection stage. So, maybe you are saying to us right now that you've been born again for 7 years. The question is, 7 years, what have you done with your Christianity? Christianity is a gift that God has given to us. This is not a religion. It's a gift that God has imparted to people on the world to be able to live the life of God here on earth. That's what Christianity is. It's not a religion. It is being impacted with the very lifestyle of God. But how you live it, what you do with that Christianity, is based on you. Christianity is not going to do anything for you. You say, what? Because all the time when the preachers were preaching to you, they told you that, come to Jesus and something will be done for you. But Jesus has given you Christianity as a gift. Most of the times, the things that you are praying and you are asking Jesus to do, he has already done them. But when he was on the cross, he said, it is what?
It is finished.
It is finished. Yes. That means all the works that Jesus had to do in relation with your salvation and Christianity, he finished them. Whatever has to happen afterwards, my brother, my sister, is based on your understanding.
Hallelujah.
Is based on your knowledge that you have acquired after having been saved.
Thank you, Lord
Jesus. Otherwise, you can be a Christian for as many years as you can mention, and still Christianity will not do anything for you. I know Christians who say, you know, before I was born again, things, as you actually find me right, things used to move. But now that I am born again, it seems like it's tough. Because they were expecting that after having come to Christianity, something will start happening for them. But you see, it is you that has to do something with your Christianity.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
So I want to teach you something that is very powerful, and I want you to very listen to me very, with all of your ears, all of your spirit, all of your heart, all of your mind.
Thank you, Spirit.
Listening to what I'm teaching right now.
Hallelujah.
I will give you seven. I said seven, right?
Yes,
seven factors of Christianity. Or like we've put it here, of fruitful Christianity, because we want your Christianity to be fruitful. Being fruitful is a mandate. It's not an option. It's required of every Christian that you must be fruitful. For he said, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he cuts what? He cuts off. You do not want to be cut off. Imagine, you are expecting that since you have come to Christ now, he should do everything that you are expecting him to do for you. And he himself is also saying that if you're not doing anything with this or what he has given to you, he will cut you off. That means he's expecting you to understand what you're supposed to do with this Christianity. And if you don't understand, it's not his problem. Because he has brought you into your inheritance, but it's up to you. So then I commend you unto the word of his grace, which is able to what? To build you up and to give you an inheritance amongst them which are sanctified. So he has already sanctified you. You are amongst the sanctified. But what you are going to enjoy is based on you giving yourself to the word of God so that you may be built up. I can't overemphasize this. You need the word of God. You need to be always around an atmosphere that teaches the word of God. The teaching ministry is paramount. The teaching ministry is everything. Maybe you belong to a spiritual organization that you call ministry. But in that spiritual organization, they hardly teach the word of God. And you know, it's so nice when they're even saying it. You know, I know pastors that like to say, ministers that like to say when they get on the pulpit, I'm not even here for 10 minutes, I'll be out of your way. And I always wondered to myself, how can you dress up on Sunday just to come and say something for 10 minutes? Do you know what Baptist and Paul taught? If I had an option, I would do that. I would teach 24, I think we should have 24 hours of word medicine. Hallelujah. But as Paul so taught all night, until somebody was sitting under the cliff of the window, fell into a slumber, as Paul was teaching. But then the boys fell on the other side, and he hit the back of his head, and he died. As though that was enough to stop Paul. But then Paul went down, put the boy up, laid hands on the boy, declared him alive again, and put him back where he was. And he continued his sermon.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Why? Because whatever Paul was teaching was enough and was important for the building of their spirits. Maybe that's how the gospel got to us today. Because someone was built up by Paul and he also passed on the same message to other people. You can be a Christian for 10 years. I ask Christians when I go around the world, you ask them simple questions. Who is Jesus? They don't know. What did Jesus come to do? They don't know. The very salvation that this is what Christianity is all about. It's all about that we are saved, right? You ask them about the very salvation. They don't know. What are the ways of salvation? They don't know. And they've been in the body of Christ for a long time. They boast about being in church for 10 years. They are the ones that correct people that come. And they tell them, whatever you are doing in church, this is what we're doing. We've been doing this church for 10 years now. We know how these things are done.
Who is Jesus?
But you just want to know, these are the factors of Christianity. What makes Christianity Christianity? Why are you still struggling for a long time? Let me just say something here before I get to this sermon. Years back, it used to trouble me. Why? I don't know if it has happened with you before. Where you have things that you used to do, probably prayer. Prayers that you used to pray, and they seemingly would come fast results. You even boast amongst other friends and say, me? When I just a simple prayer, even if I say mosquito, every mosquito in the house dies, it dies instantly. That's how swift your prayer was. And then you, somehow, after some time now, you pray even the same prayers. Same faith. Same way you used to pray those prayers. But it seems as though God no longer answers you. Now it troubles you. I don't know if you've ever been there. You used to have prayers that you would pray and God seemed to answer you very speedily. But now you pray and those prayers don't seem to come in that kind of answer. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Remember, he says, leaving the elementary teachings of the gospel, let us then now go unto perfection. In the book of 1 Corinthians 3, Paul says, and I do not write unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, as unto spiritual babes. Because he says, by now I expect that you by now, you should be even teachers. That means every one of us should grow to a stage of being able to teach others. You can't teach others when you don't know the gospel yourself. What are you going to teach? You see, even when all of us, some of you here, you went to school, right? Rather, almost all of us went to school. But I'm saying some of you, you got to a point where, besides going to school, you would even start teaching other people what you also learned when?
At school.
Some of you have become teachers yourself. Mm-hmm. That means the proof that you have really known what you have been taught all your time at school is when you're now able to also transfer the same knowledge to somebody else. Perfectly well that they are also able to grow. There is a realm of teachers.
Thank you, Lord.
Apostle John says, I write unto you, fathers, for you have overcome. These ones have overcome. They're not overcoming. No. He says, I write unto you, young men, for you are overcoming what? The evil one. Young men are in the battle. They have grown. But he says, I write unto you, babes, that you see not. You see, babes are still struggling with. He tells you their levels.
Yeah.
These ones are still fighting sin. It's their level. And God bears with them from that level. But they are Christians. 5 years he has been a Christian, he's still struggling with an addiction. 5 years he has been a Christian, there are still sins that he's still trying to get out of his system. Even though he understands, he claims to understand the message of salvation. Our Christianity should have levels. You know, I'm a teacher of the Word of God. This is one of my very strongest anointings that God has given to me. He gave me a teaching and a healing ministry. And as I teach, I know that there are different classes in the house of God. There are about 4 classes that we teach at every given point in time. But of course, we emphasize 3. The babes, the young men, and the what? And the fathers. Now, when the word of God is coming to you, at which class do you receive the word of God? Do not know that there are people, even if they can pass by this broadcast, as long as they don't see people jumping, they will even criticize that we are actually seated down. You are even seated down teaching. You should be on fire. They think fire is all about jumping. Meanwhile, Jesus had all the fire. And you don't see Jesus jumping around everywhere. They think, you know, if you're not clamoring, if you're not making noise, then there is no gospel. The gospel to them is how, even if you've ever been at home and you're watching these God channels,
yeah.
The channels you pass by, before you see their visual, you hear their noise. You know, now we've come to the channel. They feel it is in the noise. At the end of the day, people have yet nothing. Maybe you're a minister and you're watching me, and all you have been doing before lockdown is you come to church, you even announce it. I'm going to be out of your way in 10 minutes. Then we're going to show power. Power. No, because if you keep on teaching, they don't think that this is powerful. They think the power is when you just exhort people for 10 minutes. 10 minutes. You just want, you catch one word. One word. And Jesus was passing by Capernaum. I'm telling you, my brother, Jesus is passing by your situation. And then he goes with Jesus, he's passing by, Jesus is passing by for 10 minutes. Even he's already sweating, he's done. He's done, 10 minutes, Jesus is passing by. Then now, all of you, you have a spirit of laziness, spirit of every kind of spirits, come, and they are delivering people. Who are you? I'm laziness. Where did you come from? I came from here. And this is how most of us right now have been even doing church. Then 2 hours is given to the demons. 10 minutes is given to the word of God.
Lord have mercy.
They get home, we ask, what did you hear in church today?
I heard that
Jesus was passing by. But what do you want to read? Anyway, I'm going to cheat up with you. Can I share something?
Yes, Pastor. Hallelujah.
And sometimes when we step on toes like this, you should already know that it's because Jesus wants us to step on toes so that we can correct ourselves. And I'm not speaking out of envy or jealousy. Listen, I deliver more demons than most of these deliverance ministers that call themselves deliverance ministers. There is no ministry in the Bible that is called in the term deliverance ministry. But we have it today. We have it today. And it has become even so prevalent. Doesn't Jesus deliver? He does.
Hallelujah.
And like I'm saying, you should be able to understand that this message is not coming from someone who is not given grace in terms of dealing with demons. Just for your own information, let me just share something with you just for 1 minute so that we can get to the point. I'm just laying a foundation here. Do you know that you can never finish demons? Never. Well, let me just shock you again. Demons are not a race. Angels are not a race. Every angel is different from another angel. Every demon is different from the other demon.
Praise the Lord.
Secondly, there are more demons on earth than there are human beings.
Praise the Lord.
So, having cast them out from here, tomorrow they will be there again. Having cast them out from here, tomorrow they will be there again. Does that mean we should not cast them out? No. That's why this is the first sign of believers, not even of Christians, of those that have come to salvation. The newer babe says that, and in my name they shall not cast out. That means everyone should be able to do this thing. We cast them out from where on our presence. But having cast them out and done nothing about the situation, is not doing anything. Listen to me. The devil, the senior of them, is not moved that you cast out devils. If there is something that moves the devil, the casting out of demons everywhere on people's lives, as you are seeing, does not really trouble the devil. I know that I may be shocking you here. If you had a company and you had too much merchandise, you are selling everywhere, would you be so troubled because you have had just a few number of those every Sunday on one day of the week or whichever day is at which they do services? Would you be troubled if some of those merchandise have been broken and so forth when you have a large industry that is running throughout it? Or you will simply just replace that again tomorrow? So the ministry of casting out of devils is not a ministry. It can't be a ministry. Ministry is service. That is not a service. That is clearing the way for the service.
Praise the Lord.
Okay.
That's why he said again, after you have cast out the demon, he simply just lingers around and waits for you to go.
voices.
Not even voices. By the door, they to be waiting for people. As they leave the same service, the same demon says they come back to their, he calls them their house, says their house, to find out if after having been cleared, something was put in.
Yes,
but then when he realizes, it is still my house.
Empty.
It is as empty, but it has just been cleared. But he does not only come back, he goes and asks for more, because there are actually more demons without bodies than there are those that have possessed people. So you see how many demons are. So he goes and asks for more to say, come and fill every house, every corner of that person, so we can become even more fortified. That's why most people that like spiritology, I'm using the word spiritology, you know, ministry of always coming out of demons and all that, they are always in that kind of ministry. They will always need deliverance, because all they are doing is cycling demons. They push them out to come them to, for them to come back. Push them out for them to come back. Remember, when the demon entered the person in the first place, there was no convulsion. He was walking on the road and then he started I think now I'm demonized. No. The demon entered for a particular reason, because the atmospheres in the person were conducive for the demon to come in. The only way somebody can become demon free, I said there are stages. The elementary stages are the deliverance stages. But this deliverance grows. He says, and he has been preaching deliverance. Talk about Jesus, Luke chapter 4, verse 18, going down. That he went about preaching. So there is the preaching of deliverance. There is the kind of deliverance that goes out because somebody has heard a sermon.
Hallelujah.
Can you give me a name?
Amen.
The things you struggle with are because of the things you don't know. He says, my people perish because of the what?
Lack of knowledge.
Of the lack of knowledge. You don't perish because no one is casting out demons in your life. You perish because of what you don't know. Are you ready for the word?
Praise the Lord.
Seven factors of Christianity, of fruitful Christianity. Number one, it is the new creature and salvation. This is the first factor of Christianity. If you are going to be a Christian, you must have an understanding of your new creature, of your new nature, and this package of salvation. Christianity is not a religion. It begins by being born again. You see, John 3 says to us, and unless a man is born again, he cannot what? See the kingdom of God. This is, unless a man is born of water and of spirit, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Are you born of the Spirit? Christianity begins by being born of the Spirit. Give me the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. It's a popular verse that most Christians pass by without much understanding. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17.
Praise the Lord. Therefore, if any man be in Christ,
if any man be in Christ,
he is a new creature.
He is a new creature.
Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
Behold, all things are become new.
Hallelujah.
The new creature in Christ Jesus is a new kind of person. You have to have an understanding of what the gospel means by that. I'm going to read Titus 2, verse 11 to 14. You have to understand what that Bible says, means by that. You see, we all should have the history of mankind. How Adam sinned from the Garden of Eden. And how he fell short of the glory of God, according to the book of Romans 3, verse 23 to 24. And that man needed redemption to be brought back into the state which God had created man to be. When man sinned, his nature changed. That's why everybody who has been born according to the flesh has been born after the order of the first Adam, who is now born a sinner. You are not a sinner because you have sinned. You are a sinner because you have been born by the nature of Adam, who was born, who was a sinner from the beginning. And that nature, everyone who was born after that time, was born after that nature of sin. That is what needs to be corrected. Jesus does not forgive sins. Jesus forgives sinners.
Praise the Lord.
Listen to this very carefully. What needs to be washed away from the person? You see, it's a smaller truth to say we are washing away your sins. The real truth is, he is taking away the sinner in you. Can you give me an amen?
Amen.
He is killing the sinner in you. Titus chapter 2 from verse 11.
For the grace of God
that
bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men.
For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men. This has been given. Listen to me very well there. Even as we're taking higher truth this morning.
Hallelujah.
Salvation is not for Christians. Salvation is for all men. It has appeared to all men. Jesus came to save the world, not to save the Christian. The Christian does not need salvation. The Christian is a result of the salvation work of Christ.
Praise the Lord.
He came for the world. Can you give me an amen?
Amen.
And now that the world has been saved, they need to understand that the grace of God has appeared to them. Can you give me an amen?
Praise the Lord.
Read to me that verse, continue.
Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world.
Teaching us that we should live righteously and soberly and godly in this present world. Praise the Lord.
Looking for that blessed hope
mm-hmm.
and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works.
I want you to see something there that is very powerful.
Hallelujah.
The Bible says here that who gave himself, verse 14. I want to read verse 14 again. He says, who gave himself nature of sin unto himself? But then he who knew no sin became what?
Sin
became sin for us. So he became the very nature of sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Can you give me an amen?
Amen.
Read the book of Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 4 to 10.
But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he has loved us, even when we were dead in sins.
So God loved us even when we were what?
Dead
in sins.
And quickened us together with Christ.
And he has quickened us together with Christ.
By grace ye are saved.
And by grace you are saved.
And has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Okay, just wait there. We are saved by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. What do we mean by grace? This is his divine benevolence, his divine mercy that has been poured out for us. But now we are saved. Not of our own works. He needs you to understand that salvation is not your own work.
Hallelujah.
This is the work of Jesus Christ. This is the redemptive work of Jesus Christ for mankind. That's how you are saved. So, you are saved by grace. Through faith in what Jesus has done for you. All you need to do is to believe. When you believe, you connect to his redemptive work for you. Can you give me an amen?
Amen.
Verse 8.
For by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves.
Uh-huh.
It is the gift of God.
It is the gift of God.
Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained, and that we should walk in them.
And which God had foreordained that we should walk in them. I will come back to verse 10 because it's very powerful. You see, he has saved us, and now he has predestined us unto good works. There is a reason for the saving that he has done, so that he may bring us into something that is very important and very powerful.
Hallelujah.
He says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Coming into Christ, your very nature is the one which was changed. Jesus changed you from the inside. He gave you a new nature in your spirit. So, he said, and they that have been baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. Yes. Say, I've put on Christ.
I've put on Christ.
This is your new life.
Hallelujah.
You have put on Christ.
I've put on Christ.
You are now clothed in Christ.
I'm clothed in Christ.
Before you were clothed with the nature of the first Adam, who is a sinner. It says, but now you are clothed with the nature of the second and the last Adam, Jesus Christ. You are clothed with him. You must understand this, my brother, my sister. You must understand this. You have been brought out from the dimension of sin, and you have been brought into a level, into a nature where you are now in Christ.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
I like how Galatians 3 puts the word baptized into Christ. Baptized into Christ is very powerful. It means that you have been fully immersed into him. How do I help you with this? A Christian is not a little Christ. God says, you know, we're like little Christ. No. A Christian is the one that has been baptized. You have been baptized fully into Christ. Jesus Christ fully now lives in you. And as you have given, it says your life is hid together in Christ. So your own is no longer there. Your life has been hid in Christ. He says that, and for you are dead in Christ. And the life which you are living now is the life that Jesus has given unto you.
Hallelujah.
Can you read for them? Read Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Colossians chapter 3.
From this one.
Yes.
Colossians 3 verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God.
Uh-huh.
Set your affection on things above, not on the things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Mortify therefore.
No. I want you to just end there.
Praise the Lord.
All right. Read again verse 3 to verse 4.
For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God.
Mm-hmm.
When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory.
Understand this scripture. It says, for you are dead. You are dead.
Oh, you are dead.
Salvation didn't come to panel-beat you. Salvation didn't come to refurbish you. Salvation came to take away the life that you had before. The life of sin. The sin nature in you. In the book of Titus, it uses the word regeneration. Quickly turn over Titus chapter 3, verse 5. Titus chapter 3, verse 5.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Not by works of righteousness which you have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah. By the washing of regeneration. Regen is the word. Generation, that means a change of gene. A transference.
Hallelujah.
It says by the renewing.
Praise the Lord.
If you understand this, then now you are living Christianity.
Hallelujah.
Regeneration is what took place in the day you were saved. This is a factor of Christianity.
Praise the Lord.
No, with how powerful these things are, I'm not so sure if I'm going to be able to save it today. My God.
Praise the Lord.
The very genes to which you were born are no longer the genes to which you are living with now that you are born again.
Hallelujah.
There are those who erroneously teach that a Christian has two natures. There is nothing like that.
Yes.
Being born again is not to be given another nature, then you are remaining with the human nature. It is a supplanting.
Hallelujah.
Of the nature that you had before and being given a new nature. As a born again Christian, you are no longer according to your totem, according to your surname which you had here on earth. You are no longer traceable here on earth.
Praise the Lord.
It's difficult for many to accept.
Hallelujah.
Because some people, they even like their human ethnicities. How you know me more, how much is that, what happened, those things are not for you.
Hallelujah.
You are of Christ.
Praise not the Lord.
Your life is now hid in Christ.
That's
the issue. Read for them again, verse 5.
It says, not by the works of righteousness which ye have done. This is Titus 3.
Yes.
Not by the works of righteousness which ye have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. By the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost.
The washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost.
Praise the Lord.
To be born again means you are a new person. It means you are, that's why we're using the word the new creature. New creature means that you are now a different species of being.
Hallelujah.
A creature that did not exist before.
Hallelujah.
You are no longer the one that is known according to the flesh. It says, now no longer we know men according to the what? According to the flesh, verse 16 of the same chapter. But if any man is in Christ, he's a what? He's a new creature.
Hallelujah.
All things are passed away. He has now become, everything about him is new, and everything about him comes from God. He cannot be traced to sin. He cannot be traced to infirmity. You see why Christians suffer? That means if in your family, for example, there is those conditions that are what? That are generational. You know, there are generational diseases in your family, generational cases in your family. Being born again means that you have been cut off from that generation.
Hallelujah.
You are now regenerated to function according to Christ. Your genes now are the genes of God. That's what it means. You are a new creature. But as even angels long to look unto these things, they are wondering, what kind of creature is this? He looks exactly like God. He is born by the same genes of God. He says that the seed of God remaineth in you, therefore he cannot sin. Can you give me an amen?
Hallelujah.
In 1 John, he says, for whatsoever is born of God sinneth not. Why does he say sinneth not? Because when you are born of God, you have been born now according to the very genes of God.
Yes.
Can God sin?
No.
Can God be sick?
No.
Can God be broke?
No.
These are the genes that you have been regenerated with.
Hallelujah.
This is the true meaning of salvation. Salvation does not mean, the sins I used to do before, I do no longer. That is not salvation. That is repentance. Are you listening to what I'm saying now? Salvation does not mean, I no longer, I used to smoke, but now I'm a church goer. That is not salvation. The salvation work of Christ came to make you a new creature. Came to make you a new species of being. A new person altogether. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
I said hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
You know, I can dwell the whole year on this one alone. By it is not of our own works. By grace, this salvation has come. It was by the grace of the Lord Jesus that he saw us, that by our own works we could not be righteous. By our own works we could not be saved. By our own works we could not meet up to his standard. Then he came on earth by his love and by his grace. And when he came on earth, he took on your nature on that day on the cross. But then on that day on the cross, the sins of mankind were laid upon him. But then he cried out, my father, why have you forsaken me? Why? Because sin was now in him. And he died as a sinner, even though he knew no sin. So that he can take your place in sin.
Hallelujah.
No Christian is a sinner.
Amen.
You see, that's why he writes in the book of Ephesians, whenever he is reproving them of sins in the Bible, you should be able to understand he speaks to different classes. Mostly he speaks to babes. But he also has a language which he uses to speak to them. For example, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, he says to them, and no longer should you do these works of the flesh. And then he mentions them, fornication, adultery, idolatry, lying, you know, homosexuality. He mentions almost each and every one of some of them. Then he says, but such were some of you.
Hallelujah.
Mark the terminology. Such were. He says, such are some of you.
But says, are
such were. Oh, hallelujah. Read the verse.
And such were some of you.
Such were some of you.
But ye are washed.
But you are washed.
But ye are sanctified.
But you are sanctified.
But ye are justified.
But you are justified.
In the name of the Lord Jesus.
In the name of the Lord Jesus.
And by the Spirit of our God.
And by the Spirit of
hallelujah.
Our God.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
He didn't say, listen to me. You don't call a Christian a fornicator.
Hallelujah.
You don't call a Christian an adulterer.
Hey.
A Christian is not a fornicator.
Oh, hallelujah.
We say, but I know that one fornicates. Listen to me. He may be still doing works of the flesh because he's a babe.
Hey.
That is spiritual immaturity. But who he is does not change because of the thing that have happened on the flesh.
Praise the Lord.
These are the sins of the flesh.
Hey.
Do you understand what I'm saying now?
Praise the Lord.
A sinner, no matter how much good he is, he lives right. He claims he lives right. He does everything according to his own book and according to the law. He is still a sinner. Because what is a sinner in him is not because he lies, he cheats, he steals, he kills. No. What is a sinner in him is the very nature to which he was born. All men are born sinners.
Praise the Lord.
Because they are born after the order of Adam.
Yes,
but says now there is a second and the last Adam.
Hallelujah.
Who is Jesus Christ our Lord.
He
says, but you are washed. He didn't say, but you are being washed.
Hallelujah.
Or you are washed every time you confess. Move away from that level of always trying to confess your sins. I'm going to teach you about that very in the next coming teachings that are going to be having online. I've sinned again. I need to confess. Listen to me. You have not been called into Christ to be confessing your sins. All your sins were laid on him. Are you listening to what I'm saying now?
Amen.
All your sins were laid on him. Past, present, and future. All your sins were laid on him. All you need to do is to function in the righteousness of God that they have given unto you. Because he has brought you unto salvation. He says, but you are washed. And it didn't only wash you, he sanctified you. And it didn't only sanctify you, he justified you.
All
that to be justified, you now been declared not guilty. You have been acquitted righteous. This is who you are. Listen to me. A sinner can do right. He do not change his nature. He is righteous. He is a sinner rather. And a righteous man is not righteous because of the works he does. He is righteous because of the nature to which he has been given.
Hallelujah. Praise
the Lord. Have an understanding of salvation.
Hallelujah.
My brother, my sister, Christ came to give you something more than what you are living.
Praise
many Lord. Have made a caricature of Christianity.
Hey.
They are living this life so... Sometimes you feel for them. You feel for them. Oh, they're always praying, crying. They cry tears like this. You remember years ago when we used to pray? When we were very young believers. And every time we'll be praying, Pastor Mama will be there and we'll be crying. You ask brother, come up by there. Until I realized this crying is beyond washing. One day I had to ask him, why do you always cry every time when we are washing, we are praying and we are doing all other things? Then he says, I remember, I told. You know, remember Gideon's Bible? The international Gideon's in the National New Testament. He says, because of that, every time I feel I need to confess this thing before the Lord. Many of you are in that category. Every time you are praying, the devil is reminding you. You. And this, but he is the what?
Accuser.
He is the accuser of the brethren. He says, accusing you. Hey, how can you be praying? Remember what you did yesterday. Remember what you did this morning. Remember this thing, then you start crying. Lord, forgive me. And this is your Christianity. Even now, angels, when they see you coming to pray, they look at you and they shake their heads like this. Because they know your prayer is not consistent with who you are. You don't know who you are.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I think we have to do another podcast for this one. Let me try and move because of time. Number two. Seven factors of fruitful Christianity. Number two, righteousness.
Praise the Lord.
Righteousness. Romans chapter 3, verse 21 to 26. Righteousness is a second factor of Christianity that I want to give you this morning. Yes, you can read to us.
But now the righteousness of God
without the law is manifested.
Yes.
Being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe.
Uh-huh.
For there is no difference.
Yes.
For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
Being justified freely by the grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Whom God yet set forth to be the propitiation through faith in his blood.
He says we are justified freely. Justified freely. Freely. Uh-huh.
Justified freely by the grace of God through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus.
Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. This is the only way of justification. The only way justification means to be made right.
Hallelujah.
To be acquitted righteous. To be declared not guilty. He says the only way this is done is through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. It is by his grace. You believe in the redemptive work of Jesus Christ, you come out as a justified man.
Hallelujah.
You come out as a righteous man.
Amen.
Righteousness means you have been brought into right standing with God.
Hallelujah.
Without any sense of shame, without any sense of guilt or condemnation. It is to stand right before God. Can you imagine? You as a human being now has an opportunity to be able to stand before a holy God without any sense of shame. Any sense of guilt, any sense of condemnation. You stand before him righteous. Not because you've been living right, no, but because he has given you his righteousness as a gift.
Praise the Lord.
And when you receive that gift, you become righteous.
Hallelujah.
That's what Christ came to give unto you. Can you give me an amen?
Amen.
2 Corinthians
5,
verse 18 to 21. You have been justified and brought to right standing with God. You have been given the gift of righteousness. Romans chapter 5 verse 17 explains that. That means you are no longer a sinner saved by grace. You know, if you listen to these teachings, you realize certain things that have been in the body of Christ for a long time. But then God winks at certain things for a long time. The book of Exodus says so. But it says, now God commands men everywhere to repent. That means there are things that God will allow you when you are a babe. They seemingly work at that level.
Praise the Lord.
But there are times when you have come to perfection, God now expects certain things from you.
Yes.
He expects you to function with an understanding.
Praise the Lord.
You see? Oh, wretched man I am. I've been saved by the grace of God. It's sweet to say so. You know, it sounds like humility. When you are saying it before God, you say,
that's the end.
You know, I'm reminded of certain prayers that I've always heard when I was growing up. You would wonder to yourself. You would wonder to yourself. Lord, we are nothing before you. He himself says you are something. Did you see that verse? And he has washed them and presented unto himself a peculiar people. He calls you a peculiar person. You are calling yourself, oh, we are nothing before you.
Disobedience.
Hey. And you feel you are being holy for saying that. You feel you are actually, listen to me. When you hear what I teach, your life is made for life.
Praise the Lord.
You have been doing certain things for a long time. Listen to me. This Christian that you have been living for a long time is not even working for you. Can't you see? This begging Christianity. This Christianity of trying to be small every time. Small before people. Small before God. Small before everyone. It's not going to work for you. Understand what he has made you. It is only when you have this understanding that you are going to be able to live it.
Hallelujah.
2 Corinthians 5 verse 18 to 21. Read to us.
2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18. And all things are of God.
Uh-huh.
Who hath reconciled us to himself by Christ Jesus.
He has reconciled us to himself by Christ Jesus.
And he hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation.
And he has given to us the ministry of reconciliation.
To wit that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Not imputing their trespasses unto them.
Oh, hallelujah.
And they committed unto us the word of reconciliation.
The redemptive work of Jesus Christ, it is his work. All you need to do is to believe. He says, to wit, God was in Christ. So when Jesus came here, God was the one in Christ. Reconciling the world unto himself. It is his love that has brought us here. It is His love that He took us up while we were, but while we were yet sinners. He loved us and He died for us. He loved us while we were yet sinners, and He called us from all over the world, and He died for us. Do you see now? Then says, and He has been reconciling the world unto Himself, not imputing their sins upon them.
Praise the Lord.
I mean, He's not holding their sins against them, but He has taken that sin nature unto Himself. This was the next verse.
Now,
Now
then, we are ambassadors of Christ.
As though
God did beseech you by us. We pray in Christ's stead, be reconciled to God.
Mm-hmm.
For he hath made Him to be sin for us,
yes,
who knew no sin.
Him who knew no sin has been made sin for us,
that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him.
That we might be made the righteousness of God in Him.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
In Ephesians 2 verse 10, it says that you have been recreated unto good works. That is, you have been made for righteous works.
Hallelujah.
This is who you are. You have been created by God now. You are able to live right now because He has given you righteousness as a gift into your life. Hallelujah. You are able now to live out righteously. You are able now to act righteously, amen, to talk righteously, to think righteously. He has given us the mindset of the what? Of the righteous. So you are able to think righteously, to talk righteously. Why? Because He has given you righteousness. What God expects is for you to do something with the gift He has given you. That's how you make your Christianity fruitful. And these are seven factors of fruitful Christianity. Make your Christian life fruitful. Why? How? Take advantage of what He has given to you. He has given you salvation. I told you salvation has made you a new creature.
Praise
then number two, in doing that, He gave you a right standing with Him.
Yes.
A nature that is able to live what He expects of you. Can you give me an amen?
Hallelujah.
Come on, say amen to that.
Praise the Lord.
So, I cannot fail to live right when I'm a Christian. I cannot fail to live perfectly when I'm a Christian. I can live perfect. I can live right. Why? Because He has given me the power and the ability to be able to do so. Righteousness is the very nature of God imparted into your spirit to be able to live like God. God does not sin. You can live without sinning. God does not get sick. You can live without getting sick. Listen to me. You can live exactly how God lives His life because He has given you the empowerment. The empowerment. In today's language, we'll say, God has given you the software to be able to live like Him. What makes Him be able to do the thing that He's able to do? He has downloaded that software into your system. And that software is called righteousness.
Praise God.
I'm able to live like God.
Hallelujah.
I'm able to think like God. I'm able to talk like God.
Hallelujah.
Don't believe those who say, no one in this world is perfect. I am perfect as my Father in heaven is perfect.
Hallelujah.
Jesus said, be ye perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Don't be people say, I know you can't live without doing things wrong. Listen to me. This is the faith that you have that you manifest.
Praise the Lord.
If your faith believes you will always live erring, you will always be erring.
Yes.
But if your faith is set on what God has given unto you, it says, therefore now train the members of your body to live according to this new software that has been put on the inside of you, which is the software of righteousness.
Yes.
Number three, eternal life was given to you as a factor of Christianity. Eternal life.
Hallelujah.
1 John chapter 5, verse 11 to 13. Eternal life. Now, the word eternal life really does not really explain it properly, but that's the closest English can be able to get.
Oh, hallelujah.
Read to us from verse 11.
And this is the record.
Yes.
That God hath given to us eternal life.
This is the testimony.
Praise the Lord.
This is the record that God
written.
Not is going to give us.
Oh, hallelujah.
God has given to us eternal life. And this life is in His Son. And he that has the Son has that life.
Praise the Lord.
And he that does not have the Son of God does not have this life. When you have received Jesus Christ as the Son, have you received Jesus Christ as the Son of God?
Amen.
He says, and now you have this life.
Amen.
He didn't say you are going to have it.
Oh, hallelujah.
He says, now you what? You have this life. Because Zabra has this. Read verse 13.
These things I have written unto you.
These things I have written unto you.
That you believe
That you that believe
on the name of the Son of God.
That you believe on the name of the Son of God.
That he may know
that you may
know. Have eternal life.
He wants you to know. It's important. That you may know.
That he may know.
Many Christians don't know. Mm. This is very important. Key your spirit to the teaching of the word.
Hallelujah.
You can be born again for 10 years and never know that you have eternal life. What is eternal life? You ask a full grown Christian, they read this verse from when they were at, read the verse for them. John 3 verse 16. They were at where?
For God so loved the world.
Yes. For God so loved the world. That God gave his own what?
Because of the Son.
That whosoever believes in him shall not perish. But shall what? Have
eternal life.
Have. Woo. When you believe you what? You have. It didn't say you are going to have it when you get to heaven. It didn't say you are going to have it when we live in the afterlife, in the paradise, as they call it. So then, he that believes will what? Will have eternal life. Post it to us and tell us boldly and say, I have eternal life.
I have eternal life.
Eternal life is the very pulsating life of God. Oh. The word is Zoe. Can someone say so? Say Zoe.
Zoe.
Zoe is the God kind of life. To say eternal life, you know, I'm saying it's the little that English can be able to give to us. Life unending. Life everlasting.
Oh.
Life undying. Life indestructible.
Yeah.
Life unquenchable. This is the life that you have been given by God.
So,
and I want you to know that you have this kind of life. Verse 4 of course, chapter 3, what did he say? Say, and when Christ, who is our life, say, Christ is my life.
Christ is my life.
One more time, say, boldly, say, Christ is my life.
Christ is my life.
When Christ, who is our life, manzo kade bronte kisa. When Christ, who is our life,
hallelujah.
Your life is no longer your own. When Christ, who is your life,
hallelujah.
Oh, I said, when Christ, who is your life,
Christ is my life.
So I don't frustrate the grace of God.
Praise the Lord.
Why? Christ has been given unto me.
Oh,
says the life that I live in the flesh, now I live by faith in the what? In the Son of God. Says it is no longer I that lives, but Christ that lives in me. It is no longer you that lives. Christ lives in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Can you say amen?
Praise the Lord.
He has given you his very life. The life that God lives. I said the God kind of life.
Hallelujah.
There is the man kind of life. There is the animal kind of life. There is the tree kind of life. You know, the plant kind of life. Then he said that there is also the one, the God kind of life. Oh, Mantebele Bahastis. Oh, Zumandele
Bahastis. Hallelujah.
Malabahastis. Peter said that, and through these precious promises, that you might become partakers of the divine nature. The divine nature that is not even properly rendered. That may become partakers of the God kind. Is to be able to live the very life that God is able to live. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
He wants you to live like God.
Hallelujah.
He has given you everything necessary to live like God will live. Does God get sick?
No.
I said, does God get broke?
No.
You see why Christians live a painful life, a life of pain, a life of penury, a life of struggling, a life of poverty. This is not the God kind of life. Why are you living this kind of life continually when Christ has come to give you life? Then the thief comes not only but to steal, to kill, and to destroy, but I am come that you might have life and life in abundance. My brother, my sister, Christ came to give you life and life to the full. Life to the full, to the fullness of life.
Yes.
Life in this ever. Oh.
Hallelujah.
Do you know that Jesus does not give you life? Jesus is the life. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said unto Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. That one who is the resurrection and the life dwells on the inside of you.
Praise the Lord.
No Christian should be poor.
Hallelujah.
If you are poor, you are poor for your own reasons.
Hey.
No Christian should be sick.
Praise
if
God.
You are sick, you are sick for your own reasons. You say, what? I'm telling you now, the life to which you have been given does not have. Let me bring you up higher. You see, it is not God's plan to heal a Christian. A Christian cannot be healed.
Yeah, yeah.
It is not God's plan to heal a son of God. A son of God does not require healing.
Hey.
Healing is children's bread. Why? The nepios. The word children, that means nepios. That means spiritual babes. It is the bread of spiritual babes. Those that have come to age, oh, Kabo Nebahazedes. Says that if there is any, if me is not even expected in the church, says if there is any sick amongst you,
chance.
Says let them come unto the what?
Elders.
The elders. Now, elders cannot be the ones with gray hair because he explains the elders there.
Yes.
Elders, not that I've been in church for 10 years. You can be in church for 10 years and still be amongst the babes.
Hey.
Spiritual growth is not organic. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Spiritual growth is not biological.
Praise the Lord.
You grow when you determine to grow.
Praise the Lord.
If you don't determine to grow, you can be there for 20 years and still be a babe.
Amen.
That's how it is in the realm of the spirit. Now, so when they come unto the elders, who will then lay their hands on them and release oil so that they may be healed? Which means we know the elders, number one, because elders don't get sick.
Praise God.
They are the ones to heal others that have gotten sick.
Praise the Lord.
Are you an elder in Christ?
Amen.
I don't get sick.
I don't get sick.
I don't get broke.
I don't get broke.
This is the life that has been given unto me. It is the God kind of life.
Hallelujah.
The life that is superior to sickness.
Amen.
The life that is superior to disease.
Praise
the
Lord.
Life that is superior to infirmity.
Yes.
Can you shout amen?
Amen.
This is the life that you have been given.
Yeah.
And this is the life that is something to shout about.
Praise
just
the Lord.
Knowing you have this kind of life, you see, God gave you this life. You say, what happens then when I become sick? Listen to me, if sickness attacks you, because it's an attack, it cannot be part of you, it's an attack. If sickness attacks you, you have life from within you, inherent ability from within you. Cause Zebra Halebo has this. Just therefore you shall receive what? Power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. So you have power from within.
Yes.
This power comes with the life which God has given unto you.
Yes.
All you need to do is to stir it up into action.
Praise the Lord. Strong.
Listen to me, even the human life on its own, when God made it, he made it in such a way that within it, it has in itself immune system that is able to heal any kind of virus that comes upon it. But because it is in the flesh, it is weakened. And let me tell you the truth. The one that God gave for Adam was enough to heal anything that Adam ever met. But now it has been weakened by sin. That's because of sin, death came into what? Into effect. That is the failure of things to operate in the way in which they were designed. So already the human life on its own is able to perform healings. Can you see? You hit against a stone. Without going to the doctor, without doing anything, it just starts healing by itself.
Yes.
The immune system is able to do that. Unless the disease has come now in a higher force because spirits take advantage of that. Otherwise, in the natural, it's supposed to be able to heal by itself. Now you have been given the eternal life.
Hallelujah.
This one is able to detect anything that comes into your body from the realm of the spirit and is able to superimpose the life of God into your life.
Amen.
Can you shout amen?
Amen.
Eternal life. Someone say, I have eternal life.
I have
the God kind of life.
I
need to say this as well as I'm passing by because I'm sharing meat today.
Yeah.
Eternal life. The life of God means that you have been separated from death.
Hey.
Separated. He says, nah, he that is the Son of God has this life. This life is superior to death. Then he that does not believe shall perish. He who believes shall not perish. Death in all its components has been defeated.
Praise the Lord.
By the life of God in you.
Amen.
So you see, no Christian should die. No Christian.
Hallelujah.
Why do Christians die? They die because of their lack of knowledge. He says it in the Bible that and they know not. Neither do they understand. They walk on in darkness. But I have said unto you,
ye are
new creature, gods. You see, he has told you from as a prophecy from back then. And all of you are the sons of the Most High. How can a son of the Most High be perishing and dying here in this world? By rudiments of this world that control the elements of this world. You are far above.
Far.
So, and you have been raised up together with Christ and set together with Christ far above all these rudiments and all the principalities of this world.
Above.
You are not just above, far above.
Hallelujah.
I function from that realm. It is a realm of dominion. It is a realm of authority. Can you say amen? Living the life that God has given unto you. It is superior to death.
Hallelujah.
It is superior to sickness.
Amen.
I have been given life everlasting.
Everlasting.
Say it boldly, say everlasting.
Everlasting.
You know, when we're children, we used to have a sweet that is called everlasting.
Yes.
We didn't have anything after that. We just say everlasting.
Yeah.
What? You would eat the sweet and not finish. Of course, eventually it will finish because that's in the natural. But this one, he says it's life everlasting.
Oh,
glory.
Hallelujah.
I have life everlasting.
Hallelujah.
Let me bring this to a close for today.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
My life does not decay.
Infallible.
My life is incorruptible.
My life is incorruptible.
He says, being born again, you are born of the incorruptible seed of the word of God. Incorruptible. Incorruptible. Undying. Undecayable. Incorruptible. This is the love that God has given unto you. Get it into your system.
Hallelujah.
I'll teach the other four that are very important next week. But I'll just run through them now so that we can bring this to a close. Number four, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. This is a factor of Christianity. In the book of John, Jesus promised us, chapter 14, verse 16 to 20. He said, and I will come back unto you. He said so. He told us he is coming back unto us. He told us, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come back unto you. And I will send you another helper, Allos Parakletos, one exactly like Jesus, of the same kind. And he shall be your helper. He shall be your comforter, your counselor, your advocate. So that I shall send him unto you. You need the Holy Spirit. The Christian life is not possible without the Holy Spirit. That's why sometimes even without sharing things like this, someone is just lost and amazed. You see, without the Holy Spirit, you cannot hear anything I say. Particularly me, you can't hear anything I say. Because the things I speak, they are inspired by the Holy Ghost. It is only when you have the Spirit of God that you start having an understanding of these things. Even if you are a Christian for a long time, remember the book of Acts chapter 19.
Yes.
Paul passed by a church in Ephesus. And he started talking about the Holy Ghost. And they said to him, we have not even known that there is any Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
But they were a church. You can be a Christian. You can be a church. And not know that there is any Holy Ghost. Unfortunately, we have churches even today that they have shut out the Holy Spirit in their lives. They have taken him away. They've given him no space. They teach it according to their own religion. Without the Holy Spirit, Christianity is a dead religion. The Holy Spirit is the life of Christianity. He is the life of the Father manifested to us. We don't have the Father today. We don't have Jesus today. But we see him and we fellowship with him through the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You need the Holy Ghost in your life.
Yes.
He says, tarry in Jerusalem. I need to tell you its importance. He says, tarry in Jerusalem until you are endued with the power from on high. He says, don't go. These guys were ready to go. They had been with Jesus for 3.5 years. They had heard the gospel. They had been taught. They had seen the men die and rise from the dead. All these things, they were raring to go and preach. Nothing could stop them. And just said to them, don't go anywhere until you have received the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Because without the Holy Spirit, you would go nowhere. Ephesians 1, verse 32 to 14. So then the Holy Spirit has been given unto us as a down payment. You know you are going to heaven when you have the Holy Spirit. He is the down payment of the purchase that Jesus has done into your life. The down payment. Why are you so troubled with demons every day? You don't have the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you. The Holy Ghost cannot be in you and the demon is in you at the same time. You are not in fellowship with the Holy Spirit. There is no Christianity without the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Are you listening to me?
Amen.
In John 16, verse 18, he tells us that, and he shall guide you into all truth. He teaches us all things. It is the Holy Spirit that is able to teach you all things, to teach you all truth. Without the Holy Spirit, who is going to teach you? He says, for you don't need any man to teach you anymore, because the anointing in you, what? Teaches you all things. What does he mean? The anointing there is the Holy Spirit. Even now as I'm teaching you under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Without him, I'm just another just teacher, I'm just saying things that cannot be even heard. Right now I speak like this and it comes with a force, with the power to change, with the power to transform. Because it's coming from the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
He is the power of God.
Thank you, Lord.
But he's also the person of God. Most people are acquainted with the Holy Spirit as the power of God. They know the power. So when we say the Holy Spirit, all they know is shaking. Christianity is not all about shaking. Because all they know is the power, the shaking, the miracles, the healings, and the speaking in tongues, and all these other things. That's the power of the Holy Spirit at work. He is also a person. He is the very personality of God.
Hey.
Whom you must be able to fellowship with. And relate with personally to yourself. You know your Christian life is fruitful.
Hmm.
when you are living every day and you are in fellowship with the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Spirit.
Every day.
Hallelujah.
Every day. I learned from Pastor Benny Hinn many years ago from a book, Good Morning, Holy Spirit. I had never known that you can wake up and say, Good morning, Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
All we knew was we pray, and you will fill us. Then we will fall, and then we will jump. We were so acquainted with His power, and we were enjoying it until we found out you can wake up in the morning, sit down on your chair, say, Good morning, Holy Spirit. It's a fellowshipping with Him. That fellowshipping with Him. Churches have left these things. Today, nobody talks about salvation and baptisms anymore. Nobody teaches people righteousness. They think if they preach sin more, then people will stop sinning. This is their problem. Say, no, you hear pastors telling each other, this week I'll be hammering. And people now, I see people now are doing a lot of wrong. I'll be hammering it. And the more they teach it, the more they sin. Because that's what is taught. You become what you are taught. They think that they are trapped. You don't, I've always said, you don't show what is right by hammering what is wrong. You switch on the light and darkness knows where to go.
Yes.
People are living in the wrong because they don't know what's right. Teach righteousness. Let everybody know that they are understanding with God and live it. It doesn't matter what they have done in the morning. They have to still confess, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Until it has come to their consciousness. Because what is lacking is not being right. They are right with God. What is lacking is a consciousness of righteousness.
Hallelujah.
The same with eternal life. Yes. People die because of the consciousness of death. It has been driven into our system. We think death, we speak death. That's why we die. The death and life is what? It's in the power of the tongue. But if you're now having the consciousness of life, you live in life. We'll teach again number 5 on faith. Faith. Faith is a factor of Christianity. Because without faith, it is impossible for you to what?
Please God.
To please God. And number 6, on love. Faith worketh by what?
By love.
Christianity is a life of love. Once we lose love, we have lost our essence as the church. You have lost the essence of Christianity if you don't have love. Number 7. It is the authority, the blessing, and the dominion of Christ. God gave us the gift of the blessing when He made man. If you have been redeemed, you must be redeemed back to the blessing. The blessing makes you to live in authority, the authority that Christ took when He defeated the devil. That's what Adam lost. And the dominion that Adam lost in the garden to Satan. He has been restored unto us. That's the one we are using even right now to defeat him in this pandemic. That's the one that we use to control nations, to control our cities, to declare the victory of the church over anything that we want to see.
Hallelujah.
These are 7 factors of Christianity. So we're going to do part 2 next week. Make sure to connect with us.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But right now, from wherever you are watching us from, maybe you just tuned into this broadcast, or you are watching this broadcast as a rebroadcast, and you have not given your life to Jesus. All the things I taught today will have no meaning to you if you're not saved. Jesus has already died for you. He has already made everything necessary provisions for your salvation.
Hallelujah.
All He needs from you is to believe. It is to believe. If you will believe in Jesus today, your sins are washed away and the sinner in you has been removed. And He will give you the gift of righteousness and He will fill you with the Holy Spirit so that you may be able to live for Him from today. You might say, I've been a Christian. I tried to be a Christian before, but I could not be able to live. So yes, because you were trying to do it according to your own works. But today, believe in Him. And let Him impart you with His righteousness and be able to live for Him. And He will give you eternal life. Now in this time and in the world to come, you will be able to live and not die. And you'll be able to live with Him forever and ever in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Lift up your hands where you are. You want to receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Say, Lord Jesus,
yes.
Lord Jesus,
come into my heart.
Come into my heart.
I open up my heart today.
I open up my heart today
to receive you.
To receive you.
To receive life.
To receive life.
To receive salvation.
To receive salvation.
I believe in Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
And I believe that God raised him from the dead for my salvation and for my justification. I believe. And today, I confess that I am a son of God. I follow Jesus forward ever and backward never. In Jesus' name.
Jesus.
I pray for you right now that by the grace of God be filled with the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit fill you now from wherever you are watching us from. You belong to Jesus. Yes, you belong to Jesus. From today you are snatched away from the devil. You are snatched away from hell. You are snatched away from eternal fire and condemnation. And the Spirit of God gives you righteousness and eternal life in the name of our Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Now, for any reason, if you are sick in your body, as the word of God was coming, eternal life in you defeats sickness.
Hallelujah.
The life that God has given to you, the God kind of life, the Zoe God kind of life, is superior to sickness, to disease, to infirmity. I pray for you right now. Be healed in your body. If there is any demon responsible for your situation, I command you to leave now.
Amen.
Yes, the Holy Spirit is touching you now. In the name of our Lord Jesus. Yes, that power is being stirred up from within you. The Holy Ghost in you is perambulating in your body, healing you from any condition, from any pain. You are healed in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Now I'll give you this opportunity one more time. Take out your seed that you are going to sow unto God. The kingdom of God is a kingdom of sowing and reaping. It is a kingdom of giving and receiving. And Jesus said, give and shall be given back unto you, a good measure pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Never get tired of sowing. This is our culture in the kingdom. The more you give, the more it is given back unto you. Even in this time of the pandemic, take out your seed right now. I'm about to pray for you. You are going to live in divine supplies. That's the life that God has called out for you. And it is hidden in these instructions. Because there are many Christians, they know these things, but they don't do the instructions that God asks of them. And they wonder why they continue broke, even though they've been in Christ for a long time. Be a giver. Be a giver. The more you give, the more is given back unto you. You are sowing in the realm of the Spirit. You are creating altars. An altar is an open portal between the realm of the spirit to which you belong and the realm of the natural. When you do that, you get a constant flow. There are angels that have been only assigned for money. Those angels work with you only if you are a giver. And I'm praying for you right now as you are sowing your seeds. Take out your seeds, take the details there, save them, and see how you send that seed to us. And I pray for each and every one person, even here, that is sowing in this place. That the angels of finance, the angels of prosperity, the angels of money in the kingdom of God shall function with you in the name of Jesus. You will never walk run dry. No, you will never see scarcity. And as a priest of God, I cause the blessing to rest upon you and upon your home. In the name of Jesus. Yes. Yes, I declare that you're not affected by the lockdown in different parts of the world. In the name of Jesus, you are exempted. And when men shall say there is a casting down, you shall speak a different language. Your 2020 is not spoiled. No. You are fruitful in your finances. You are fruitful in every area and in every endeavor of your life.
You are separated from the pain of the world. Zumanta brahala gosho de bonte brahastis. Malendo brohozo kobo hastis. Praise the Lord. Thank you so much for joining us. Remember, we are going to be on again next week. Seven factors of fruitful Christianity. Even part two. Make sure that you join in 11 a.m. on Sunday. We're going to have a song, even as we close. And as the song is going on, as the ministration is going on, give. Don't let this opportunity pass you by. Make sure that you have sown. The song is going to play, and you are going to be keeping on sowing, even as you enjoy the ministry of this song. God bless you.
Say, I can do anything. Come on, say, I can do anything. Oh, you can call me Superman. Hallelujah. You can call me Superman. Hallelujah. Come on, sing it now. Not by sight. Come on, sing it. He's given me the ability. He's given me ability. So why don't you take a good look at me, hallelujah. So take a good look at me. Oh, he's giving me, I'm living in prosperity, yeah. I'm living in prosperity. Said it's not by power, nor by might. No, it's not by power, nor by might. Ah, hallelujah, glory be to God. Say, I'm a new creation. I am a new creation, born of the seed of Abraham. I know who I am. I'm wonderfully, fearfully made.